Horror, horror, horror movie?
What?
Let's make a horror movie?
I wonder what we'll be like then. Brains in jars, I'm gonna guess.
We're a long way for God now, son.
Slowly
coming out of his mouth.
Crawling out of his mouth and stretching his skin.
No. So he doesn't save them, the bridge goes down, people die. And he's like, oh well, job done. Clarence?
Can we try take two again?
Yeah. All I'm saying is maybe don't trust sentient hats to make life-changing decisions. But
thanks for your correspondence, J-Tops.
Welcome to episode 9 of Let's Make a Horror Movie. I'm Dave.
And I'm John.
This is the podcast where each episode we take it in turns to pitch the other one a horror movie idea, a first draft, and one that welcomes any and all improvements, both from the opposing host, but also from you, Lamamians.
Yeah, or Johns.
Or Johns. If you're a John team person, then you can call yourself a John by all means.
Yeah, yeah.
But how's you like that? That's compromise.
Calling out to my John brethren out there.
And for all of you Lamamians, you're Team Dave. So one of us pictures the other one a movie idea, horror movie idea, and the other one builds on it like muskrats building a lodge.
Ooh, I like that.
You go, muskrat is similar to a beaver, but not quite the same.
Oh, no. Worlds apart.
They're not that worlds apart.
Two different
lanes. They're so similar, I had to Google what the difference was, and beavers have flat, wide tails. Muskrats have thin tails,
yeah.
And they also show more of their body when they're swimming.
Mate, I know all this.
I know why I'm telling you. I know why I'm telling you.
Boring to me.
Anyway, as always, you can contact us at letsmakeahorrormovie@gmail.com or on Twitter at lamampod. That's L-M-A-H-M pod. And we're also on Instagram, and you can call us on 01011 01011.
I think. Yeah. It's beef.
You've got a binary phone, right? Everyone's got binary.
Yeah, everything's binary these days.
Yeah. Everything
it's
is
all
binary.
Ones and zeros, mate. We've all seen the Matrix. Yeah.
That is such a 11001 thing to say.
Oh, don't.
So, quick things then, for anyone that's new, this podcast has three acts. The first act, we cover off feedback from last week.
Yep, this was your pitch.
That's right.
Yeah, interesting, looking forward to feedback.
Spoils of War.
Yes.
Which, you came up with that name. I think it's my favourite name of all of the names so far.
I was pleased with it.
And so, act two...
We cover all of culture from last fortnight.
There you go.
No stone is left unturned.
Yeah. And act three is the pitch itself.
Which is my pitch this week.
It is episode 9 odds. That means it's a John week.
Yep.
So,
one of the odd ones.
Yeah. We're learning. We're like...
Every fortnight we're getting better.
We're like big babies.
Yeah, yeah.
With equipment that we shouldn't have. We're like big babies with plant equipment.
Yep.
You know, like diggers and shit. And we're like, you know, figuring out what the levers do.
The first two episodes, we could barely even hold our heads up without choking. Now...
I almost died a cot death.
You did? Or you playing the old drinking game out there and drink for cot death.
Okay, so yeah, for anyone playing the Dave or John says something so offensive that they get rid of 99% of their listeners, take your drink now.
Sid, take a shot.
Yeah.
God.
Yeah, okay. I went in hard
that
one. So maybe that will make it.
On a slight caveat, for my voice is a little bit croaky today. Mm. I mean, I say today, as I was driving here, I sang very loudly to Rammstein and really hurt my throat. I don't know how he does it. That German man, he's very good.
I think he doesn't do it a lot anymore, I think. It's probably
he does it a lot.
Touring a lot?
Yeah, they've got a new album out, so I'll sing along to.
Fuck me.
Really good.
Well, I'll have to get my... I'm clearly a few years behind in my Rammstein knowledge.
Yeah, yeah. Your like knowledge of heavy metal is really out of date, mate.
Mm.
You're still singing Mutter.
Like a fucking idiot.
It's embarrassing. Maybe if we go out.
I think we should... Move on to act one.
I think we should move on.
Yeah, okay. So, hello.
I said all I'm going to say on that.
Feedback on last week.
Yes. Spoils of War.
So, first bit of feedback is from Mothman educated story construction expert and friend of the show, J-Dubs. And I haven't read this yet, so let's crack in.
Ooh.
Dear Dave and Kajon.
Okay.
That's spelled K-J-Y-O-N.
Yep. I'm happy with that.
I'm writing this from my oyster room on an unseasonably warm evening. Bit rushed, so forgive the lack of lyrical genius. So, titles, he suggests for Spoils of War.
Noun and a place?
Well, yeah, he normally goes for noun and a place, and you set him a challenge last week. He's gone with Banter in Byzantine? It's going to have to be Byzantium, J-Dubs. Banter in Byzantium.
I like that.
That's pretty good.
That's very nice.
The Cappadocian Caper.
That's brilliant.
That is fun.
That's really good.
if the Muppets do a version,
and they're going to do one of all of our movies.
Yeah. Romanus Euns Domum. Oh, you didn't provide a translation. What's a Roman? Am I going to have to Google that?
I'm rusty on my
Romans
ancient languages.
He's such a bastard for making me do this. Domum. Yeah. How about we translate it? Google, yeah? Not just...
Everyone's got a working knowledge of Latin.
Use all your dodged tacks. Oh, here we go. An intentionally garbled Latin phrase from Monty Python's Life of Brian. Oh, fucking hell, I didn't get it. Yeah, it's Romans Go Home. It's when he writes it on the... which is actually, ironically, one of my favourite scenes of anything ever.
Yeah.
I didn't pick up on the reference, so... Pretty,
It's embarrassing, that.
Pretty embarrassing.
Yeah. Do you want to cut now and then go, Life of Brian?
Good Life of Brian joke, J-Dubs.
Seamless.
His favourite, Lumpy Romans. So J-Dubs goes on to say, you might have to kill the cold open as this is a lot of exposition for something you later use to build tension. So he's talking about the presence or lack of supernatural influence.
No, I think that's actually not a bad shout, actually. Because if you think about, like, Dusk Till Dawn, I think you name-checked in the thing, there was no cold open in Vampire-y. I don't think there was anywhere.
Yeah, no, that's true.
Yeah.
No, yeah, you're right. It might have to take out the... Yeah, I get your point, J-Dubs. Yeah, that's a fair point. We should probably it just sacrificing.
Yeah.
So, it's gone. John's
quit up. Exact power of this.
He says smoke should be penetrating the wider region, causing cruelty, but I'm going to change that to could, because I'm sure you didn't mean to be so presumptuous.
embarrassing.
This is the trying to draw people to the apparent safety of the city. Could be suggested in minor mutations on locals. That's quite a fun idea.
I quite like that, actually. Because, I like the implication that it is kind of like a trap.
Yeah.
So I think that feeds into that quite nicely.
In the sequence where the scouts get lost when saving the girl child, they could become deprived of their scout manual recognised methods for navigation, i.e. no moon, no stars, fucked up magnetic field. He puts in brackets, I have not fact-checked the use of compasses in Byzantine times, or Byzantine... I managed to get through the last episode without making a mess of that every time.
No, you did it very clean.
And now it's just a complete mess. So he's saying, fucked up magnetic field with a suggestion of an unnatural cause. I feel like the evil smoke might steal the show in this movie. Potentially blue on blue, when the scouts meet the survivors on level 3, the altered state and lack of expectation of finding friendly faces would potentially lead to a strike first type response. Also straight out of the scouting manual. This would cut short the time and clarity by which the main characters get any exposition of their situation. This leaves more room for exposition via torchlight and some jump scares, which would be awesome.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, awesome. I think he's nailing it.
Need to tie in the body horror to the monster with some more purpose. It is connected just now, but tenuously perhaps, as Kijon suggested, their behaviour is modified to meet the monster's needs. Otherwise, this appears to be just for visuals. Yeah, that as well. Perhaps the monster was imprisoned by a selfless sacrifice. To escape, the soldiers need to do the same. Following this, the whole city may begin to implode and the surviving scouts need to fight their way out of the chaos. Otherwise, what happens to all the levels of people? All dead following a horrific implosion or roaming the earth as UKIP? I know what I prefer, he says. Postscript thoughts. Is it just me, or could the Assad description just sound like a beetle? Yeah, true.
What, like
six limbs, hard shell, roundish beetle. It did say covered in eyes. Yeah. And, yeah, three arms, three legs. I feel like beetles... Don't most insects have even numbers of... Oh, do you know what? I'm pulling that straight out of the old Richard Gere.
I mean, it could look beetle-esque. I saw it more as like a weird boglin.
Yeah, I actually am boglin.
That was my go-to, but with little legs.
Mm. Well, I wanted it to be... So I wanted it to be huge and almost unwieldy. So you don't even see it all. Mm. You can't see it all. Like it's too big. Yeah. So whatever's moving through the smoke isn't necessarily it, but it's some sort of manifestation.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I'd seen it. Obviously, I didn't say any of that. I just imagined that
it was all implied, mate.
Oh, you've got to read between the
It's all
lines.
The words you aren't saying.
Yeah. The best stories that I've done are all in the subtext.
Yeah. Layers upon layers, mate.
I'd never be so obtuse and bold as to actually write them down and say them out loud.
Yeah. I mean, it's a bit gauche, isn't it? To actually tell a story like that.
Yeah, read between the lines. Love the fact that one of the most implausible elements, massive underground city, is real.
Yeah, Marvel is awesome.
It is very cool. Names for the listeners. Hey. Right now, John's is too close to the truth. I'll bet a good percentage of the listeners are me. Yeah, probably. How about mammies? Right, because the mammies.
Yeah, mammies.
I mean, it sounds bad. Exec producers. Yeah, actually, that's a good show.
That's really good.
Yeah, that is Maybe really we good. Should do that. Mammies. Apostles of Clarence is suddenly become my favourite. Or editors. Apostles of Clarence or exec producers. That's winning it for me.
I quite like editors.
What, the band?
Yeah, I do quite like the band, actually. Saw them live once, got seated. Bit of a small regret. Because it looked like it was people dancing quite a lot.
Well.
Yeah, it's just one of my rich stories.
What I loved is that it had a beginning, middle, and an end.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, Johnny Usenoff, they call me.
Please find attached a musical submission based on my favourite character. I thought of a few alternative names for your characters. Expositionist, voiceover guy. Extratus, guy who dies first. Everymanus, y'all's main character. Pertwinius, your man Sean. For anyone that missed that, we for some reason had a bit of a love-in about Sean Pertwee last week.
Yeah.
Out of nowhere.
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't make it any less true.
Yeah, no, always welcome.
He says, don't forget best friends Jordius and his black and white armour, and Oceanus in his cork hat and large knife. Also the old scouts, Grizzlius and Longbeardedus.
I don't think he's taking this very seriously.
I feel like...
He's having fun.
That's not why we're here. Cool. Oh, yeah, actually, also, on that, Stray Doves has made us a little song based on this. So we're all watching the violence together before one of the men says... Clarence? No, let me try that again. Clarence?
Can we try take two again?
Clarence.
A lot going on there.
Busy.
Who's that? Kill Jester.
If you want to hear that in the flesh, so to speak, look in the comments. Maybe there'll be a link.
Hear it in the comfort of your own homes, as it were. Thanks, J-Dubs.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, J-Dubs, for that. As always, that's brilliant. And
lovely bit of joining in.
Thanks to Kill Jester, / J-Dubs. I don't know. I think that's it. Did you get any feedback this week?
Not particularly. I mean,
we are recording early. We're recording early because you're selfishly doing stuff on the Fortnite.
I am difficult, but you know I'm worth it.
You're doing an escape room.
I am doing an escape room.
Do you know what the theme is?
Yeah, Sherlock, the TV series.
Someone has to be Martin Freeman then.
Oh, hopefully me.
Oh, really?
Martin Freeman's all right.
Fuck that. If you had to choose to be either Cumberbatch as Sherlock or Martin Freeman's Watson,
I think
you're still picking Watson.
You're overlooking the depth of my self-loathing. I don't see myself as a Cumberbatch anymore, even on my best day. I mean, I'll be thankful to be a Freeman.
Yeah, you could do Vodafone ads and a whole load of shit.
He's all right.
He is definitely all right. Even in the books, like, Watson is not the character that you want to be. You want to be Holmes. He's like a fucking boxer.
Yeah.
He chases the dragon.
Yeah.
He's got it all.
But it looks like it's hard work being Holmes. So you have to do a lot.
No, I read it the other way. I feel like it's so easy for him. Yeah. That's why he's an opium addict.
True. But, you know, Watson's got a walking stick, and I've always thought that'd complete my look.
Yeah, and a limp.
Yeah.
So it's not just, you don't just get the stick.
He was in not a bad African zombie movie recently.
Oh, yeah, what's that one called?
Oh, The Package or something, The Parcel. Something like that.
Is it the one where he's got his kids, like a baby?
Yeah. He's got a little nipper in tow, yeah.
Yeah, I saw that, and I went, oh, interesting concept. And then I didn't want to watch it, because Martin Freeman, it was just Martin Freeman, basically. And I see enough of him on Vodafone adverts.
Yeah, you've been watching him all day, don't you?
All day.
Yeah, big vote head.
Oh, I'm a vote head.
Yeah.
Yeah, big vote head.
Yeah.
You know, Martin Freeman profits off the fact that they don't pay tax in any really true sense, or at least they dodge a shitload.
Yeah.
One of the many reasons to love Martin Freeman.
Is this like a kind of like CO2 leak in it?
Dude, I'm an absolute mess.
Even by our standards, I'm not sure where this is going. So you've had a little taste, a little cheeky extra of Act Two.
Mm.
A little amuse bouche.
You mean technically that's a palate cleanser. But look, hey, who wants to get into technicalities? I was finishing Jeff and Anne van der Meer's anthology Sisters of the Revolution, which I mentioned a few episodes back that I was starting. I've just been dragging my feet a bit because busy life. But it's fucking great. Every story in it is a gem, and there are a couple of really, really good standout stories. If you're a short story fan, you're not going to go wrong with this book.
If you're a fan of the written word, I think Jeff van der Meer is, you could do a lot worse.
Yeah, and that's me. What about you? You've done shit loads though, come on.
What have I been
doing?
You've
watched shit, you were tweeting about shit.
Oh yeah, Tigers aren't Afraid. Or Tigers Are Not Afraid. Unbelievable, maybe movie of the year. It's on Shudder. Everybody who's listening to this who hasn't got Shudder, you've only gotten half the experience, in my mind. Shudder is almost the companion piece to this podcast.
Yes.
I mean, because Shudder is phenomenal. Tiger's Not Afraid is not only is it the best horror film of the year, it might be the best movie of the year. It's
And so it's overtaken Daniel's Not Real, then.
It might do. I mean, they are a very worse than apart. They're both very powerful movies. You know what? I won't say anything about Tigers Not Afraid because it's a very Guillermo del Toro-esque thing. But it's set in Mexico. It's quite grim. It's like a lot of sort of like hyper-real dark fantasy.
Mm.
It will kick you in the heart. It's brilliant.
That sounds great. I mean, people have been losing their shit about
it.
And to be fair, Daniel isn't real. I got one more thing to say for Act Two, unless there's anything else you want to jump in with.
I finished The Institute. It's really good.
Yeah, and you're starting to read Doctor Sleep.
Yes, because the movie's coming out in about a few weeks. So far, it's really good.
The only other thing I was going to say, moving on, is next month is October.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I'm overly excited.
Do you want to say, because your idea...
Okay, yeah, so we're thinking of doing sort of seasons.
Not thinking.
Oh, no, not thinking.
We're doing Halloween.
Yeah, we're doing it.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of doing seasonal pictures. So for October, we're going to do Halloween-based pictures. We're both open to interpret that in any way that we see fit.
Yeah.
And I'm suggesting maybe we'd even do a Christmas one, perhaps even Easter. Because that'd be fun.
Yeah, and there's about to be more religious public holidays we can sort of.
Oh man, I've always sketched out an idea of Jesus coming back angry. Do you know what? I genuinely have written something about that.
Yeah, why not? That'd be fucking.
I really did write that.
I would watch that.
I once wrote a little comedy short story for my own benefit of Jesus spending 2,000 years training to come back to get revenge, and every time he's about to
on
come
who?
Back on the Romans.
Oh.
Specifically the Romans. Very clearly
he's gone
the Romans.
Very broad with his blame, isn't he?
Yeah. No, definitely the Romans. And every time he's about to come back, he finds out that basically there's new weaponry, so he trains again.
Mm-mm.
And all the angels keep kind of saying to him, it's been a while, Jesus, do you want to calm down? It's all right.
Yeah.
And he's like, no. He goes, oh, no, have you ever seen M16s? I've got to get good with that because they're gonna win.
Needs to smoke a horror doobie.
Yeah, so he gets constantly trying to up his game.
I like that. I really like to hear a pitch about that in future.
I mean, might be amazed to pitch that.
But, so, from my point of view...
the point is, we're doing Halloween pictures.
We're doing Halloween pictures in October, so the next pitch will be mine in 2 weeks, then John 2 weeks after that, both of which will be in October, both of which will be Halloween themed.
Yep.
From my point of view, this is a purely commercial decision.
Mm-hmm.
I see sort of making a good Halloween film in a similar vein to making a great Christmas single.
Yep.
You know, like, it keeps on sort of paying off year
after
year.
You have got a real Freeman mindset about this.
Freemaphone. I do recognise that the remuneration structures for music and films work in different ways. So it somewhat ruins my analogy, but, you know, nonetheless, it still get a lot of chat every year. Get a lot of noise around it. I want to write Black Christmas, but for Halloween. And I know there is also Halloween that already exists. And it sort of really nailed the title as well in terms of the tying into the holiday.
They smashed it.
Yeah. So, but you know, hey, we'll figure it out.
Yeah, I mean, have we started writing mine? It's, I think it's quite fun.
I actually already started writing mine as well.
I've written more of mine.
Well, wow. So, yeah, look forward to that in the next episode and the one after that. Episode 10 and 11 will be
Halloween two-parter.
On that incendiary device, let's move on to Act 3.
Okay.
Shall we? Welcome to Act 3.
Yeah, hello to people who have probably quite wisely skipped the first two acts.
I think this one, if you're ever going to skip to the third act, I feel like this is maybe the one.
I mean,
obviously, we're telling you that now. Telling you that now is too late. So, but you know,
sorry.
If you're telling your friends, which obviously would be doing.
Of course.
I mean, we are quite a niche podcast.
We are niche.
So, John.
Okay, this is my pitch.
I thought you were almost. He left for folks that can't see us.
Yeah.
For everyone that's not watching the live feed.
Yeah. You're missing a
John,
treat.
John wasn't holding his paper, and I really thought he was just going to do it from memory. Just for that second. You looked at the paper on the table and were like, yeah. And you're like, all right, I'm ready.
Yeah, I'm going to trump this. Going off the auto cue. So there's these great people.
On both sides.
All right. So shall I just kick in?
Crack on in.
All right. Okay, so we don't have a cold open. We have credits going over a scene. A young boy with big round glasses stares at an Egyptian mummy in a museum. As the credits roll across, he barely blinks. That's the start of the movie. A young kid, probably about 12, just staring, unblinking. I'm thinking sort of like a sped up shot behind him, but he's just not moving, staring.
Oh, cool. And so it's sort of a time lapse going on behind
him. And he's non-moving, staring at this, and it all goes in the background. He's just focused.
Is it too early to ask if this is modern day or like...
Modern day. So this is like a contemporary. So this bit...
The British Museum?
Yeah, that sort of thing.
So we're UK based?
I mean, I've written it with America in mind. So probably the Natural History Museum in New York, maybe.
Okay.
But yeah, so the story's set now. So this would be like, what, 80s maybe?
Wait, no, now isn't the 80s?
No, but this is set in the past, this little bit.
Oh, this bit,
this
right,
little bit, because we're going to follow this boy as he reaches adulthood.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so this is going to be, but there's going to be no tales. Like, there's going to be no, like, you know, music at a time playing. It isn't going to be like Stranger Things, you know what I mean?
Right,
talking about,
yeah,
like, oh, Nightmare on Elm Street 5's come out. Nothing like that. It's just going to be straight. It's just going to be that.
That felt a little bit venomous.
No, do you know what? I really like Stranger Things, but there's a little bit on the nose at the end. So a young boy with big round glasses stares at an Egyptian mummy in a museum as the credits roll across. He barely blinks. 20 years later, a young man with big round glasses, the same man, the boy is now grown to a man, is cutting a body apart just out of frame. He places the organs in a jar, in jars. So like he's trying to
create the ritual. like when you're mummifying.
Exactly, yes. The man also carefully removes the heart and places it in a silver bowl. We see his face, and his face is streaming with tears, and he's whispering, I love you, repeatedly. He grabs a long-handled instrument, which he crams at the nose of the body. It is a close shot, so there is no detail of the whole body, because I don't want it to be too upsettingly grim, but it's still quite grim. Which he crams at the nose of the body. It's a close shot, but we do see that it's an elderly woman, so we see enough of like the facial features to get that from it. He swirls the instrument and extracts the brain as it pulls out. Once this is done, he moves over to the sink and vomits into it, while still weeping. He then grabs the heart with the bowl and a jar of coloured liquid with leaves and spices floating in it. He moves back to the body to continue his labour. We get a hard cut to the same man sitting alone on a sofa. He's pale and obviously shaken by his macabre work. That's the beginning, really.
So we're in act, we're...
Yeah, sort of like kind of like a semi-prologue kickoff of Act 1.
Okay, cool.
Act 1 was tapped, so this is Joshua. He's in his mid-20s, and until recently was living with his mother until she passed. He's reluctant to share many details of this to the few people who ask about her. He works at the front desk of a funeral home, where his duties are mainly administrative. The funeral home is run by an elderly couple, their son Andrew, and a few part-time members of staff. They all treat him well, but they are concerned about him, and politely suggest that he'd find other work. He's not quite suited to the work that he's doing. Hence why he's only on the front desk.
Right, because he doesn't like the dead bodies and stuff?
He has a weird, like, attachment.
And this is, Joshua is not the guy from the beginning.
No, Joshua's the guy from the beginning. Oh, Joshua's the main character. He's a kid at the start. He's the kid with the...
Cuts yes. some body up.
Yes.
Then we cut to this contemporary, same time period we've just seen. Yeah. Yeah, okay. And then we find out through some exposition.
Yes, that's his life and everything
else.
He originally intended to work with natural cadavers, but became far too emotional when he did. The family kept him on because he's a hard worker and they like him. Andrew also has a mildly flirtatious relationship with Joshua, which he enjoys it and makes Joshua humorously uncomfortable. It also seems to suggest a genuine attraction between the actual two men. Another person in his life is the elderly neighbour Clive. He was good friends with his mother. It seems that Clive has helped support Joshua and his mother for some years in many small ways, like comes around, keeps them company.
What was the name of the third guy, the flirty guy?
Andrew.
Andrew, oh.
Okay. Yeah, Andrew will be coming back later.
Oh.
He's quite upset as Joshua made it clear that his mum will not be receiving no funeral or memorial because she's passed. So his mum has died, and that's the body that we saw earlier.
Right.
And Clive's come around and kind of going, well, what are we going to do?
Yeah, when are we picking up the body?
Yeah, and he's like, no need. Sorted, it's all been handled. And he's like, well, I care about him. I want some closure. He's not going to get that. There's also a couple of school friends called Sally and Thomas.
That feels like a tricky conversation.
It is.
So where is your mum's body now? It's all taken care of?
Yeah, he's very reluctant to give any details. Mm. He's just trying to kind of give him the cold shoulder, essentially. I've dealt with it. There's no memorial. My mum didn't want that. Mm. And he's like, well, I kind of want
that. I've buried her in the back garden.
Yeah.
Like a pet.
Yeah, she's in jars, mate. His couple of school friends called Sally and Thomas, who are now a couple, but still make time for Joshua.
Thomas?
Yes, I just thought it'd be nice to add a bit of a bit
like
of
Thomas?
Yes.
M-S-Z? Like Thomas?
Thomas. Yeah, Thomas. Just Thomas.
And he's, alright, Thomas for that name. Yeah.
Simple as that, mate.
Hey!
don't get hung up on that.
Why am I even bringing up? I mean, all our friends.
I can't remember now why I made it Thomas. I think, I can't remember now. Dickens observed that their usually reserved friend has become even more closed off and difficult to reach recently. Also, Sally and Joshua did used to have a romantic relationship many years ago, but she knows Joshua better than most. They've moved to the opposite side of the state for Thomas's job, but they check in with Joshua as much as they're able. So they still regularly call him, check up on him and everything else. And also, they like him. He's a mate.
So we're following, in terms of the film, who we were following these characters, really?
No, we are following Joshua. We're just getting contact. So you probably would get like a phone call from Sally, maybe, going, how are you doing? Because your mum's been ill for a while and everything else. Act 1 ends with Joshua heading towards the basement in his house to finish the final stages of his deceased mum's mummification. A body's been dried, covered with scented oils, and stuffed with sand. Joshua then proceeds to wrap the body carefully, pausing to kiss the dried forehead once before he applying the final bandages. We also have another hard cut to Joshua sitting by his mother's bed with her prone, mummified body lying upon it. He's stroking the body, smiling as he's pleased with his work. This is probably like a time lapse of a few weeks now.
Mm.
It takes a few weeks to make an actual mummified body. I've looked this up. He's interrupted by a harsh knocking at the door. It is a drunk Clive demanding to know where Joshua's mother is and why he won't let him see her. Because he's going, well, where's the body? What's happened? And he's had a couple. It transpires that Clive was in a romantic relationship with his mother, which Joshua was actually unaware of. Clive forces his way in and eventually finds a mummified body upstairs. After searching the house quite aggressively. This leads to physical altercation as Joshua tries to explain that his mum died naturally and he was making sure that she'd be happy and complete in the afterlife. As Clive gets increasingly aggressive and attempts to call the police, Joshua sees a large looming figure of Anubis standing over Clyde with its claw on his shoulder. The giant god's glowing white eyes are expressionless, but its mouth curls in a slight snarl. Joshua smashes Clive round the face with a bedside lamp and proceeds to cave in his face and head. He then drags the body to the basement where he dismembers and burns the body in the furnace. So Joshua's not alright.
No, it doesn't sound like it.
But this is also the first time that he actually sees Anubis.
Yeah, and we see Anubis
So you kind of imply that there's a certain amount of break in him at this point. That having to defend his work and also being attacked has caused an escalation of his sort of a break in his outlook, maybe. Act 2 consists of Joshua beginning to lose his grip on reality as he sees Anubis more often in his life. No one else is aware, but a dog-headed god is sighted most around Andrew, Sally and Thomas. Every night he sleeps beside his mother's body, with Anubis crouching on the other side of the bed facing him. His health begins to obviously kind of get worsen as he stops eating. He's barely sleeping, he's barely eating, he's becoming more and more sort of broken, essentially. He interrupts a funeral day they're hosting at his work by screaming that their loved one will suffer in the afterlife because they're not properly sort of prepared.
Journey.
Throughout the whole scene, Anubis looks expressionless from behind the coffin as he causes quite a scene there. So he's starting to sort of like scream at the various mourners and saying, "You're doing this wrong. You're damning your loved one." And Anubis just stands there behind the coffin, staring at him.
Cool.
But the camera never focuses on Anubis. It's just there, almost as a background thing. So there's no real shot of it. It's just there as a large sort of large dark sort of figure. Andrew eventually manages to reach Joshua and holds him until he calms down. Joshua looks over at Anubis, who is no longer there. Andrew takes Joshua home as he's barely responsive after the funeral. He promises to stay the night, affection, concern written all over his face. Joshua falls asleep on the sofa as Andrew sits in the armchair close by, worriedly watching over him. Joshua is in this, and then you have a slight fade out as he loses consciousness. Joshua is awoken by Andrew talking frantically on the phone to somebody. It is evening outside, so quite a few hours have passed. Completely ignores the stirring Joshua. It's become clear that he has found a mummified body upstairs and is talking to the most contacted person on Joshua's phone, and that is Sally. So he's calling a friend, not the police, because he cares about him. He's kind of going, "Look, your friend, I don't know what's happening here, but there's a body upstairs. There's no foul play or anything as far as I can see."
Does he be able to... is this Andrew?
Yes.
Andrew works at the funeral home, right?
Exactly. So he sees an embalmed body, essentially. Yeah. And knows...
He'd still be like, the fuck's that doing here? But at least I can tell it's an, you know, exactly. It's not some sort of weird
corpse. And he is kind of saying down the phone, like, should I call the police? Mm. What should I do?
Yeah.
Joshua's eyes are filled with tears.
Leave the house is what I would recommend.
But then he cares, because also Joshua's going through a hard time.
So here's the thing. Who's the most recent called number on the phone? There it is. Okay, I'll type that into my phone, and I will leave the house, and I will make that call when I'm fucking miles away.
Well, I mean, Andrew's in a state of a bit of a shock at this point.
Mm.
So, Josh's eyes are filled with tears as he sees Anubis step into the room and stalk Andrew. So as Andrew paces around, Anubis is standing behind him.
I'm worried for Andrew.
It's not looking great, mate. Andrew sees that Josh is awake and tells Sally to come as fast as she can, because he's obviously very concerned. And he's saying, like, please, you've just got to get over it. I don't know how to handle this. Because he knows if he calls the police, Joshua is in a lot of trouble. Joshua tells him that she died because she was elderly and ill, and that now she'll be healthy forever in the afterlife. Argue Andrew that it is not how life works, and they're going to need to do sync with the body. Joshua screams that this is not a body, it is his mother. This scares Andrew, starts to move towards the door, because now he's started to go, this is worse than I thought. He really has had a break.
I think out of everything, that's probably the scariest thing said in the most banal way.
Yeah.
But about all the stories that we've, you know, made up, whatever, told each other so far, the idea that someone would go like, that's not a dead body, that's mother.
Yes.
I'd be like,
that's where Andrew's like, this is above my pay grade.
Old dust cloud and shoes hanging in midair, and you just hear the door slamming. And I'm fucking down.
He's now thinking, okay, Joshua's worse than I thought he was. He's not a guy who's stressed.
Yep.
He's a guy who's having a bit of a break. This scares Andrew, starts to move towards the door. Anubis, who's been behind him the whole time, snarls aggressively. Oddly enough, Andrew reacts to this, like, doesn't see Anubis, but he reacts to the noise and looks behind him. And then Joshua lunges for him. Andrew runs to the basement to escape, now out of control and snarling Joshua. Eventually, Joshua kills Andrew down there by cutting his throat. Joshua weeps as he stares into Andrew's dying eyes. He kisses him and promises that he will be whole in the afterlife.
Oh, no.
So he doesn't even see that he's actually killed the guy. He thinks, this is an unfortunate thing that's happened, but I will fix it.
Yeah, he's like,
make sure you're okay.
He's like, we're all going here anyway.
Yes.
You're just going there slightly early.
Yeah, you will understand once I've finished. Act 3. So Act 2 is probably going to be quite a lot meatier than I've written.
Yeah.
There's a fair bit more you could do with his life. It's getting worse as it goes along. So I'm doing broad bullet points here. Bits that I know. I also think in this story you wouldn't really have a B story either, because I think you'd really want to be on Joshua the whole time.
Yeah.
Because I think his mental state is the story, really. And his factor in mind is the story that it is.
Right.
I think you wouldn't want to water that down too much.
No, and I love the conceit of the sort of religious fervor where they, they're so bought into it that they don't see it as a bad thing. They actually think, conversely, it's a good thing because they're helping. Yeah. It's like that old Doug Stanhope joke where he says that you would know a Christian really believes it because they wouldn't be wearing fucking seatbelts in a car.
Yes. That's where he is now. Right. He's kind of gone off the deep end.
He's taking the seatbelt off and he's like, hey, just whenever you want to take me.
Yeah,
I'm helping this guy. It must be his time.
Yeah, he's not all right.
Yeah. Oh, turns out it's Andrew's time.
Yeah.
Who knew? And in my house as well.
Like, of all places.
Yeah. Well, lucky I'm here to help him out.
Because also, he also sees that Anubis is giving him almost like the actual go ahead to do this to Andrew with a snarl. He's like, okay, Anubis has not steered me wrong so far. Which clearly he has.
Yeah, I love that. Putting two and six together.
Exactly. Act three is Sally and Tomas reaching the house sometime during the night. So they've been driving straight away. They've just gotten straight in the car and are driving there. So probably a good couple of hours have passed. After breaking into the dark house, they go upstairs calling out to Joshua as they go. They search the house, basically.
Yeah.
They discover the mother's body, and this caused them to start to panic. Tomas goes for his phone immediately, but Joshua comes out of the darkness from the corner of the room and attacks him as he's standing in the corner of the mother's room unseen. He uses one of the implements, a large curved blade from the basement, to injure Tomas severely by slashing deep across his forearm. So literally just pretty much opens his arm.
Ugh.
Really like, you know, butterflies.
Oh, mate.
So it's a hefty wound. Tomas tries to push him back weakly from Sally, but soon passes out from the great loss of blood. Joshua stands between the exit and Sally. She's screaming for him to stop doing this, calling him a monster. Because obviously, as much as she's loyal to Joshua, she's just seen Tomas getting really badly hurt by him.
Alarm bells started.
Yeah, she's now
back,
thinking this like, is okay. This isn't Joshua now. This is he's now severely ill.
Yeah, you pass the threshold.
Yeah,
you're like, oh yeah, I thought I knew you.
Yeah.
But actually, now that I'm looking at your long dead mummified mother's corpse on your bed that you clearly sleep next to, that's probably going to be apparent looking at the bed.
Her thinking now is basically, it's always the quiet ones. Basically, her sort of mental monologue. So Joshua stands between the exit and Sally. She's screaming for him to stop doing this, calling him a monster. He replies he just wants to make sure the people that he loves will be safe in the afterlife. And he knows the secret ways to make sure that they are. As he says this, Anubis looms behind Sally out of the shadows. Joshua says that this life is constant decay and rot. And if we do nothing to preserve ourselves, then we'll continue to rot forever. In an effort to distract Joshua, Sally smashes a fist down on the mummified body on the bed, caving in the face. Joshua howls and rushes over to the body. Sally takes a chance to push back Joshua, but he turns too quickly and slides the blade straight through her chest.
Ooh.
She stares in his eyes as she dies. Joshua falls to his knees amongst the bodies as Anubis stands over him and places a hand on his shoulder. So we kind of, that's the sort of the end of the movie in a big sense.
Oh, okay.
So we then jump to the epilogue. So this is now a little bit of time has passed. So the police break into the locked house. Probably gonna be daytime. You don't know how much time has passed, and they find four mummified bodies in the beds upstairs. So in his bed, maybe just two in the mother's bed, of Andrew, Sally, Tomas, and his mum. They're surrounded by empty clothes and jars containing their organs. They're all mummified and properly taken care of and everything else. So he's had some time to himself. Mm. But people have reported them missing, so the police have now tracked them down to there. The police search the cellar and find the floor sticky with dried blood and Joshua's corpse. He died whilst trying to preserve his own organs. So he's basically opened himself and there's sort of jars where he's maybe got a couple of things into a jar, but not enough into the jars. And it's like,
playing a one-man game of operation.
Yeah, he's
on
really...
Himself.
And then we see Anubis stares expressionless from the darkness. His ear flicks, and the movie ends. And that's it.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Little short piece, little short bit of gothic horror.
I mean, look, I like it a lot.
Yeah.
Your act one is basically...
Is the mum situation. Is the mum...
He starts doing the mum.
Yeah.
It maybe ends, sort of culminates with...
It culminates with Clive, I think, with Clive's...
Clive getting done in.
Because at that point, the reason he doesn't mummify Clive is because he has no particular care for the man. Because at this point, he's attacked him.
Right.
He's challenged him. He finds out about a relationship which he didn't know about.
Mm.
Not that he's necessarily against his mum having a relationship, but he's against not knowing, not knowing something about his mum. I think it's important we don't see the mum alive in the movie.
Yeah.
I think it's quite important that we don't define her at all. I think
Deborah?
Yeah, Debs. Yeah. Old
well,
Debbie.
That's just, you know, yeah.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, she has.
Deborah, or Debs to her friends.
Yes.
But I think you're more in the mates category. Yeah,
mother to Joshua. So I think Act 1 will culminate in Clive's death
and
his body being dismembered and burnt. It's one of the reasons why I set it in America, because they tend to have sort of larger furnaces in basements. So I think Act 1 culminates in that. I think Act 2 would need a lot of Joshua's life as his mind is going. So there's going to be a lot. So I've only really put one interaction there with the funeral. But I think there probably would be a lot more stuff like that, where Anubis' presence starts to unnerve him more.
Yeah.
So I should sort of challenge his actions more. So you could pad that out a lot more than I have.
Yeah.
I've only just given a few.
You could almost get to the point where Joshua in Act 2 starts to push back against this. And it's like, hang on, no, this is fucking crazy.
Yeah.
I'm losing my mind. I can't believe I killed Clive. You know, all this kind of stuff. So that we, the audience, are like, yes, Joshua, finally.
You could have his mind really ebb and flow.
And then Act 3.
Yeah.
Flips it back, like he cracks further or whatever.
Because the end of Act 2 is essentially Andrew calling Sally and Tomas. That's really the end of Act 2. End of Act 1 is Clive's death, and then the end of Act 2 is Joshua's, basically the cat's out of the bag.
Yeah.
Somebody else now knows.
And then
now
Act 3 is
the grim sort of happenings. That's my little ditty. My little tale.
I like it. Had you got like a feeling about why this is happening or what's going on? Do you see what I mean? Is Anubis really there, or is it just a fracturing Joshua? Do you know what I mean?
I would take Anubis as a kind of an avatar for like an obsession with death, or at least a closeness with it, which is why my mind Anubis isn't
triggered
real.
By his mother's grief over his mother's death.
I think that's definitely a big part of it. And gotcha. I think the reason that I would say that Andrew had some reaction was because he works with death. And I think it also gives the audience a slight, is Anubis actually there or not? Because I mean, the end does imply that Anubis is a separate entity, because it's still there when Joshua's dead. But I didn't want to put too much on that.
Yeah.
But I thought having Andrew react to the noise gives you a little taste of
cool.
A little rough, like, oh, is he just ill? Or is he in some way influenced?
I really like that now. I'm just wondering how much I would love that if I was watching a film where that happens.
Yes.
Because, you know, we watch a lot of movies together and you know I will quite happily shout at the screen, like, why are you doing that? Why would you go in there?
Absolutely ruined the clumps for me. So
I'm just wondering whether I feel like as a viewer, whether I really needed some sort of clarity on that, whether you can get away with leaving it obscure.
I think actually you could really make it or break. You could really go one way or the other with Anubis at the end. Because if Anubis is there at the end, then it does heavily more imply that he's an entity of some description. If he's not there at the end, and the police just find Joshua's body, then that is just a figment of his imagination.
Yeah.
With the slight question mark of Andrew's reaction.
Your preference is to go with Anubis is there.
My preference is really that he isn't there.
Right.
But I just quite like the end shot of the sort of Jackalier flick, as he's just looking, as the police standing over a body, of like Joshua's grotesquely carved apart body.
I do like that a lot. I suppose my only question again is if I'm watching it as an audience, am I going to think, oh right, no, it was Anubis, it was all real?
I think you would have to. I think really you could put a lot more of that into the Act 2 stuff as well, see how much influence Anubis has over him. Depends on, if I think his actions in those scenes would really tell you a lot more. One thing that I would say I wouldn't like to see would be any sort of like prime mental illness in Joshua. So I wouldn't want it to be like he stopped taking his meds.
You're not looking for any overt.
Yeah, I don't want to blame it
whatsoever.
On. Yeah.
It needs to be ambiguous.
I don't want it to be like crazy men.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because I see it as more as somebody who is morbid and also very caring. And has found a way of marrying those two things. So his way of rationalizing his knowledge of death and his presence in his life is to rationalize and to try and fix it. And he's found a narrative with the Egyptian stuff right. that works for him. So he's kind of going, well, actually, if I care about people and people are better in the afterlife and will never decay or get ill or die,
yeah, yeah.
that's where they should all be. Because if I want them to be safe, I want them to be there.
Yeah, I like it because it's religious fundamentalism
yeah.
is what that is.
Yeah, yeah. And it's fear that, like, because that's the big... The big thing, not to get too sort of like deep on it, but the big thing about life is that it's hard because it matters. That's it.
Can I just quote that back? The big thing about life is yep. that it's hard because it matters.
Exactly. Yes.
We don't have that much sympathy for him because he was already a bit of a yeah. shit, and actually he is murdering.
I think you could have a lot of flashbacks to like to him getting a job, doing the job interview. You could have an explanation of why he's administrative and not actually doing the job he was going to do. So maybe have him
having sex with the bodies.
that's implied, mate.
I mean, I joked, but it could be that.
I'm not sure I would like that.
Sort of changes the tone of your film a bit.
Okay, a little bit. One for dads. I think.
Sorry, I'm thinking of the film I've written for next week.
Yeah, no, of course.
Yeah.
Funeral fuck party.
FFP coming your way. Two weeks.
So, yeah, I mean, I maybe had him. Maybe when he's the first time he's called upon to actually work with a cadaver and maybe approaching it either unhealthily or maybe showing some degree of emotional weakness, maybe not.
Yeah.
I don't mean by that as in getting emotional. I mean, as not being able to handle the reality of something that he thinks he can handle.
Mm.
Because even with the starting scene with the stuff of his mum's body, he's not cold and mechanical. He's broken, he's weeping, he's fraught. He's not a guy who's just going for the motions. In my mind, he's a very emotional person.
Yeah. Well, I just... And this, again, totally changes the entire tone of your film, so yeah. feel free to throw it out.
Yeah.
But I was just wondering, what if you actually had him being a murderer or some sort of weird serial killer who kills by doing the mummification ritual.
Yeah.
But then when his mum dies, Anubis actually starts appearing.
Yeah.
And then it's like, oh shit, this is different game.
I'm
going to do this properly. Like, this shit's real, I'm on it, you know. And then he's not doing it because of whatever psycho reasons.
You know what's weird with that? That was the original idea.
Oh, was it?
The original idea was to have him as just a serial killer with a motif. And I found it quite hard to write that because I couldn't really think of anywhere. I couldn't really think of a story around it except concept guy kills in this way. There is a slightly, I don't want to say autobiographical, but there is.
You did.
Yeah. I mean, you should have seen my 20s, mate. Went through jars like a motherfucker. Making people jam.
People jam is the best jam.
Yeah. It's a great band, too. But yeah, I mean, you know, that is, it's a hard thing to acclimatise yourself to. And I thought, well, maybe written somebody a touch like myself, but without that, without the healthy stuff. So he's basically someone like myself without the healthy grounded part, which makes you kind of go, that's life. That's what it is. That's how I've got to deal with it. He goes, no, I'm going to fix it. Then that's sort of, that
which
was
is,
my way.
You know, which is not an uncommon horror trope in a sense. You know, a lot of Pet Sematary is a good example of that, actually.
Yeah.
You know, definitely somebody basically trying to fix their... Yeah.
A little bit of psycho, but without the anger. Because obviously he's got a lot of anger.
All the love you've put in it.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, he's like, he's a lovely Bates.
Lovely Bates. Yeah. Well, we all like them.
I love a good bait.
Titles.
I was thinking, keeping it simple, I'm calling it Pyramid. Keeps it ambiguous. Pyramid or maybe Anubis. Something simple, or Egyptian.
Anubis, a new bat. a little bit of bis, no. Trying to make, do you know what, I'll stop trying to make puns. Yeah. Unpunnable, Anubis.
Yeah. Well, because in my mind, he is essentially making his house into a pyramid. That was the thought. They're essentially filling it full of loved ones and things.
Oh, I see. Yeah, Joshua. Yeah.
So the house is becoming a tomb to Joshua.
Yeah.
It's because he's creating his own pyramid around
himself, and all his possessions and stuff, and all the people.
And he's kind of collecting people like their possessions, essentially. That's the unhealthy part of his life.
Yeah.
Storing them.
No, that's cool.
Yeah.
I'm not loving pyramids.
No, I mean...
It's not straight away.
My wife said that she didn't like that either.
Yeah, it seems a bit... Seems a bit inaccurate somehow. Yeah, Clumsy. Yeah, I don't know.
It's not my favourite. But then Tomb was a bit vague. Mm. I didn't really like that either.
Mm.
I'm sure there's something you could do.
I mean, what I would have done was come up with a couple.
Yeah, like Spoils of War.
Mate, I'm a glass house stone thrower.
You are.
Is what I am. Anubis, his job is to weigh, you know, and then decide where they go.
Yeah.
So good or bad, basically.
Well, see, I've seen, because that's what I, so when Anubis does something to somebody, so if he puts a hand on their shoulder or snarls, that's his judgment, and that's what Joshua's acting upon. So when he sees it doing it to Clive and sees Anubis reacting like quite aggressively to him, he takes that as a judgment.
The jars of truth.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Jarhead. I don't really feel
jar that. Heart.
Heart of jars.
Heart of jars.
The jar factor, right?
Yeah, that's not bad.
Yeah.
It's not bad. I get the feeling you were going for another non-the title.
Yes. I think, I wouldn't want to give too much away, because I wouldn't want people to go into it with too much prior knowledge of what's going to, because one thing I was really, when I was writing it,
I feel like Pyramid might point in the direction of, I mean, whereas Jars of Truth.
Yeah.
You'd be like, what the fuck's that?
I think even once you watch it, you'd be like, what the fuck is this called that for? What I wanted to avoid is to have the mummification thing as purely as an affectation of the...
Is he just using, like, mason jars and shit?
No, there would be, like...
Where he's getting the actual kind of carved...
Or at least something similar, so maybe something that would look...
He's got a bit of money, then.
Yeah, he's got his mum. His mum's probably got a fair money.
Yeah. Poor old Debs.
Yeah, hardly knew her. apart from Clive did.
That terrible ostrich accident.
Let's call it the ostrich incident. Sounds like a Grisham novel.
Yeah, that's true. Debs is dead. Dead Debs. Dead Deborah. Don't know. This blue sky, that's what they call
Debs
it.
Debs in a jar.
Debs in a jar.
Jar of Debs.
Jars of Debs. Jars of Deborah. Jars of Deborah is not bad. No?
Jars of Deborah. Oh, God.
People would want to know what that was about.
Yeah, they would. That would join a lot of people. I would see Jars of Deborah.
Yeah.
Did you know what? Know what's really weird about this? I don't know if I mentioned this on the podcast. I mentioned to you that I was writing a story that I wouldn't watch.
Yes, you did, too.
And that's when this idea was about a serial killer who used mummification. Because I was right. I had the idea of somebody would do this. So I thought, that's never really been done that much in this specific way. But I thought, I wouldn't ever watch a movie with somebody just grimly putting folks in jars. It's just not the kind of movie I'd watch.
Yeah.
But I thought, I want to write it because it's stuck in my head. But I would watch it now because of the love aspect. So, you know, love jar.
I think the love jar might, I don't know.
Clive's nickname for Devon.
Oh, God.
They were close.
I know.
They were close. People find them at any age.
Love jar, though. It's a sort of thinly veiled euphemism for cum bucket. You said it. Not me. I
just to be clear, I didn't say cum bucket.
No, you said love jar.
Yeah.
Basically, all I'm saying is that's like the sort of telly, it's the pre-watershed TV version of cum bucket. And I think that's offensive.
Yeah. The pre-watershed cum bucket. So, guys, you can have cum bucket, but look, you're on half eight.
Yeah. But me halfway and call it a love jar.
You have to imply cum bucket, but you can't say it. It's not Channel 4.
Oh, I was going to say, hands of Anubis.
Yeah, I like that.
Because if the hand is going on the shoulder to signify approval.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. I think that's quite good.
Hands of Anubis?
Yeah.
Better than... Pyramid. Love jars.
Yeah, but better than love jar, cum bucket or pyramid.
Oh, just to be clear, I wasn't suggesting Cum Bucket as the name for the film.
Your eyes lit up, mate.
I was suggesting Love Jars. No, I didn't. In fact, I suggested Jars of Deborah. That's what I suggested.
Or Deborah's Jar. Hands of Anubis I like.
Hands of Anubis, yeah, there we go. I feel like it has just enough...
Yeah.
Because I feel like I'd feel shortchanged if it was just called Anubis.
Yeah, I agree.
And I went to see it and I'd be like, oh, there's hardly anything of Anubis in it.
Because Anubis doesn't do a lot. He just stands there looking...
Yeah, and he's not in it that much.
Yeah.
Probably not a lot of screen time.
I also as well, really, apart from a couple of shots, I wouldn't ever want a direct shot of Anubis. I'd rather have the camera on Joshua and then Anubis in relation to him.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's us then. If we don't, we've done titles, Hands of Anubis. Yeah.
On that IED.
I feel like that's knocking on the door of bad taste.
I'm joining in, mate. I'm following your lead.
You would not hear me touching bad taste stuff with a barge pole. What I was going to say was two things. First of all, feel free to feedback on John's story this week. Suggestions to the film, movie titles.
To be fair, particularly to J-Dubs, who's quite good at sort of padding stuff. I mean, in a nice way, as I think. I think Act 2 definitely needs a fair bit of padding. I think that would be right up his alley.
Oh.
Yeah.
Right up his Richard.
Yeah, right in his jar.
His rear love jar.
Never a good name.
If you also want to add to John's story or send any thoughts or whatnot,
mm-hmm.
letsmakehorrormovie@gmail.com or LMAHMpod on Twitter and give us a shout.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And if you like this, please do rate us and review us on whatever.
Yeah, please do.
Receptacle vehicle you're.
Yeah, I've already got quite a few bits of kind feedback and reviews, so yeah, add to it.
Yeah, but we're running out of money, so, you know, for paying them. Oh, so you got to do it for free.
Yeah, those Russians aren't cheap.
So, write in, let us know. J-Dubs, as always, look forward to your feedback. And let's make a horror movie.
And we'll see you for the October specials.
October specials.
Yeah.
Coming up.
Coming at ya.
Specials with a small asterisk.
Oh, yeah. As in very.
It'll be special to us.
Yes.
On that party popper.
Yeah. Oh, that's nice.
There you are.
I like that.
Let's make a horror movie. See you in 2 weeks.
Bye-bye.